objective today is to give some applications of high order continua in the nonlinear case. So cases where I would say, and I think Corrado will also agree with that, I think that probably we cannot escape using gradient approaches or higher order continua. Because usually in many applications you may try to use another way to model some simplification or using discrete systems. But there for the simulation of fracture, for instance, and localization, I think we need really it's an easy tool then to use. There are other examples. We have seen yesterday the case of composite with some resonance where you have not the classical field equations that you know. So you have three applications. In fact, I will show you three different cases where you need such gradient approaches. I would say first it's strain localization. I will consider a special case, a case which is a bit different, but standard strain localization with a band where you have some increased strain up to fracture. Here I will consider propagating localization. This will be the first subject. So this is this. Of course, when you have a German, you can think there is a French before, so I should say Piobert, Luders, and it was 20 years before, it was military. It was working for the army, and he has observed the phenomenon. But the publication of Luders is much more extensive. And the second case is again a size effect. That was a size effect in hardening of metals. So the fact that if you have smaller grains, for instance, in a metal, then you may have a harder material. This you may describe also by means of grain. Also in that case, I would say metallurgists use other ways, more simple ways perhaps to model it. But the effect will be clear by means of gradient approaches. And the last one that I would like to presented the case of fracture, ductile fracture. Ductile fracture. And I will take the case of forms, metallic forms. So these are the three examples that I want to show you to convince you that when you come back, you have to use these tools, some of them at least, for your some of your problems. Okay, so let's start with the first one. The model I will present is a very simple one, a very cheap model, if you want, because I will introduce only one additional degree of freedom, that you have to put in your code. And I will make the link to what is called strain gradient plasticity. You have heard the name, cannot escape in many conferences. So I want to make the link between this micromorphic approach and strain gradient plasticity. And then I will apply to a propagation of strain localization band. Okay, so the approach, I will write not so many equations. In fact, the approach is plasticity. So my objective is to start from what you know, von Mises plasticity. For von Mises, I could say Tresca for the German guys, but von Mises is von Mises, so you have no von Mises plasticity, that I will extend to a case of higher order forms. Why the word micromorphic here? You have heard it during the week, you remember. Micromorphic means you have some displacement degrees of freedom, you have additional kinematic degrees of freedom. What are they? These degrees of freedom typically means that material has a microstructure. What does it mean? It means the center of mass of the volume element is not a very rich information, you need something more. And typically you have direct dots. So you have direct dots. So So these are vectors. You have three of them because it's a trihedron. Okay. And for instance, what can it be? It can be if you have fiber composites, for instance, you can identify some specific directions and you want to follow them in the material. So these are directors. The one I prefer in my case is in plasticity, crystal plasticity. Also, what I represent will be isotropic plasticity, but I want to give some perhaps some. And there are some flags. You should take the flags, you know, nice, you can show them after. You can take one of them and do that later on. This, it works. So let's take a crystal. So the most simple crystal like that. Okay. This. Okay. Volume element of crystal. Okay. You shear it. And you know that in plasticity, you will have deformation like that. Let's say this, okay, like this, for instance. Assuming that you have too much, one is too much, okay? I created some matter here, too much creation of matter here, okay? And you have some dislocation with which wave went through, and they are equal to get away. So the lattice is like this. It's not so beautiful, but okay, you understand it. Okay, like this. Okay. And now I will write things I follow here. I will write blue and okay. I will write first a material line. Material line means that. We'll take one atom here, and another one, and you link them. This is material line element, because this is a small quantum here, and you see that it transforms like that. It's here, so it transforms. So there is an elongation and a change of rotation, which is due to which tensor, what is responsible for that? Which tensor are you using to describe this? The one which arrives here first, F. What's F? FIG. The gradient of the placement. But I am also interested in the fact that there are non-material directions here, which are the lattice direction. Lattice direction is the are parallel to rows of atoms in their order. So here, for instance, this is, in that case, you have a lattice direction, so let's call it O10, like in crystallography, for instance. And you can say, so where do you have, again, a lattice direction here? For instance, here, you have the same. Okay? This is a lattice direction, this is parallel to the atomic order, order of atoms here. This is not the material. So in fact, here it would be this one. Huh? I should go the same, for instance, parallel here, the same. Huh? But you see, it's not a material line because these atoms, or this atom here, okay, is the same, but this one is not, this one is not. So you don't have the same atoms along the line. It's not the material line. Okay? So for me, these are the, this is the director. This is a vector which is not necessarily a material. So you can follow this by diffraction, and then they transform into directors like this, in the transform configuration here. So in that case, it's an identity. Okay. But then I can stretch it and rotate it, and then the transformation is by the micromorphic deformation. Okay, so this is the initial idea of erosion and mingling of material with microstructures, and when saying microstructure, they don't say they are doing a change of scale. This is not really the case, in fact. It is a macroscopic theory, what they are doing, a phenomenological theory. But there are some characteristics of the microstructures, the directors, that you have to identify, to choose, and once you have chosen them, then the physics is fixed, and then you have to apply the techniques and find the quantitative equation, which is not so useful. Okay, so this is the micromorphic model. And then what I propose is what I call the micromorphic approach, in the sense that I will be more general than Ehringen, saying that as soon as you introduce some additional strain-like quantity as a degree of freedom, you are in this spirit of independent degrees of freedom. And here, what I propose is to introduce a scalar. Here you see small p chi here, which is now nothing special physically. It will become later, meaningfully. But this is something related to plasticity. This is a scalar, not the full micromorphic. So you lose the notion of director, because directors are related by tensor of second order, but you will see how this degree of freedom will impact. So I show this because the theory is the same as Ehringen, in fact, simply with different
key models. Is a tensor.
Sorry?
Key is a
tensor. Chi is a tensor, yeah. So second order.
Second order.
So here, I simplify, in some sense, the theory of Ehringen, saying that instead of introducing a full tensor, I will introduce a micro, scalar value. So I took microplastic equivalent strain.
That depends upon chi.
Sorry?
That depends upon chi.
No, the chi is forgotten. It replaces.
Yes, it replaces.
The chi is here to distinguish from peak, which is what you call yesterday, because we introduced the plasticity. I think you call it gamma or lambda. You know, the,
lambda, tension, and lambda.
The cumulative plastic strain.
Yeah.
What was the
accumulative plastic strain.
So you know that from plasticity. Remember your plasticity, epsilon, the strain tensor, plastic strain tensor. You have a plastic multiplier. You have a yield function. And you take the derivative with respect to the stress in the case of normality. And this is, P is a plastic multiplier, can only increase in that case, and you accumulate, it's sort of a norm that you accumulate, and this is P. This is used in microscopic plasticity for hardening, for instance. You say that if you have a lot of accumulated plastic strain, then the material is hardened. And what I do is I introduce, this is a sort of internal variable because it has an evolution law. Described by the differential equation that you know for plasticity. For instance, in rate-dependent plasticity, you have a viscoplastic expression. In rate-independent, you have a consistency equation to find the P dot. So you have a differential equation. This is an internal variable. But here, this is a degree of freedom that I produce in the spirit of Ehringen. So it's a reduced Ehringen. And it is a degree of freedom. Why? Because, in fact, it's not a hidden variable, because you have a gradient of P chi. I introduce the gradient, the effect of the gradient of P chi. So it means I postulate that there will be, in fact, energy associated with the gradient of P chi. As
Sorry, what is the
distinction
you make between the freedom and the
internal variable? Sorry, what is
the
internal variable? For me, an internal variable is driven by a differential equation, not a partial differential equation.
I would say, yes.
You can have a more thermodynamical.
So it should be longer than that.
Yes, exactly. As soon as you have some Laplace or something in it, you have to put boundary conditions, so it's sort of controllable variable, it is not anymore hidden. There is a paper by Sidorov in the 70s, a small paper, where he says that all variables are, in fact, higher order degrees of freedom, because they are solution of differential and partial differential equations. So the evolution equation is partial. But the diffusion term of the partial derivative may be very, very rapidly, so we cancel it and keep only the evolution. And this is how the concept of internal variables emerged in the 70s, at least in France, there are several schools for that. And we can see that as a sort of simplified equation. We had an example yesterday with Claude, who had a variable beta, which was driven by a differential equation. Oh, no, no gradient. So this is sort of internal variable. I think it was sort of internal mode, something like that. So it's so there is a strong difference. Yes? Not yet. It will come. Not yet. Here, I only say that it has the dimension of strain. That's the only thing. The name suggests that it will be related to plasticity. Sorry? I have to speak very loudly because. Yes, in principle, since we say that we can have boundary condition of it, in fact, we should ask for how to measure it. It's true. Okay, this is a question for the specific case we will study because we will take a specific situation, so we can look at it. And then,
excuse me.
Yeah.
You use hidden and internal as synonyms.
Yes.
Okay.
Ehringer
and Schubi, I worked with Schubi, did another distinction.
Yeah.
Internal variable is when its evolution is governed by an ordinary differential equation without its gradient.
Yeah.
Hidden, when there is an algebraic equation relating the new variable, the field you are considering, to the other fields.
So it's not given by a differential equation.
So they call it hidden variable. But of course, this is a question of names.
Yeah. Lee? Yeah. Okay. And so what is nice in the micromorphic theory is that it is a first gradient theory. It has more degrees of freedom. It's the first gradient theory. So we don't need to integrate by part 10 times. We will do it only one time. And so this is a nice thing, and you can apply, of course, the method of virtual power. So you say that the internal power, the power of internal forces, virtual power of internal forces, is a linear form with respect to the degrees of freedom and their gradient. Okay? Yes?
Why do you consider only the first gradient of this new variable?
I consider only the first gradient.
Yeah, but why is it this case?
It will be enough, in fact,
okay.
We will see. Because, of course, I could consider the second one also. You will see how it reduces to second order when you put some constraints. In fact.
Okay.
You remember during the week you said that you have the gradient theory, high order, for the second gradient, and you have the micromorphic theory, where you take the gradient of chi. And you remember that it was mentioned that you can put some constraints saying that the blue vector follows the red one, which is not true for single crystal like that, huh? So we cannot use it for that. But for other cases, you may imagine that, in fact, more or less, this vector follows the material vector. And in that case, if you take chi equal to f, and you take the gradient of chi, which is the first gradient, then you obtain the second gradient of displacement. So you have a sort of second gradient theory hidden. But formally, it remains the first gradient. Okay, here I should put, in fact, the name of Germain, because there is a very nice paper of Germain in 73, in English. This is the only one in English that I know. There are several from fluid mechanics or shockwave, I think there are some. But there is one where he presents the micromorphic theory, and even the most general micromorphic theory you can imagine when you introduce higher-order tensor. And this formulation that I show here is based on the Germain presentation. But here it's simply for scalar. So you remember we have no work for the velocity here because of objectivity. Sigma is symmetric, we know that also because of objectivity also of the power. And we have a dual quantity to p dot and a dual quantity to the gradient. So you see it's a scalar and vector. Okay, so it's the power. And the objectivity does not change it. Why? Because theta is postulated as an invariant quantity by change of observer, because it's related to plastic state, in fact. So we postulate that, and that's why it's going to stay there, especially this one. And this is essential. Now we apply the method of virtual power, so we can insist on that. We have done it several times this week. And what you get is you have two sets of degrees of freedom, you get two equations. The first equation, I don't write it, it's simply here. This is, I write it only in statics and without body forces. This is what you get by the variation of the displacement. Okay. This is a standard equation that you know. But you have a second one because of the variation of this one. And this is, she simply says that this one must be the divergence of the B vector. This is a second balance equation. Let's say balance of generalized stresses. Okay. Now we go a step further, because we are interested in the constitutive equation. Now we want to have a special system to study, so we go to the constitutive equation. Doing that, we go to the thermodynamics. And since it is a local theory, in fact, we have no change in the usual thermodynamics. We have the internal energy here. We have the power of internal forces. We have the heat flux and some reactions and things. We are translating, in fact, here. And you have the second principle. In its local form, because I can still use the standard scheme, which is, of course, very restrictive, because I localize the second principle, but which is sufficient for the approach. So in that, we have the free energy density, Helmholtz free energy density. We have the entropy, temperature, power of internal forces, and, of course, the dissipation due to heat transfer. I am interested in plasticity, so we split the strain. I will present the theory here only at small strain for simplicity. But of course you can generalize it. Ehringen did the theory at large strain. Elastic strain, plastic strain, and you assume that all the constitutive functions are dependent on the whole set of variables you have at your disposal. So you have the idea is that the free energy depends on the elastic strain, the reversible part, temperature, accumulated plastic strain, microplastic strain, its gradient. And you do it for the entropy, for the stress, for the higher order stress, and then you plug this into this, and then you make some constitutive assumptions which consist in saying what is dissipative and what is not. And this is the main discussion that you must have. Here, I have made some choices which are reflected by the state laws here. I have assumed, I will tell you, okay, there is no dissipation associated to epsilon dot. Okay. So this is Hooke's law, elasticity, hyperelasticity. Okay. The entropy is linked to the temperature. Here, this is more or less a definition here. This is simply I call R the derivative of the free energy with respect to the plastic cumulative plastic strain. This will be a hardening value. This is stress quantity. It will be a hardening value for the material. And here, this is a constitutive assumption here. I assume that there is no dissipation with due to P dot chi, which is a very crude approximation because we are interested in plasticity, so we may say you must introduce some plasticity. You can. I don't need it for the purpose here. You can make it more richer if you want. But let's assume that, we'll see what you can do with that. So no dissipation. And the same here, you see I have no split in dissipative or non-dissipative part. It's full non-dissipative here. So the higher order stresses are not dissipative stresses in this presentation, this choice. So it's very easy to extend the standard constitutive equation that you had before for Mises, because at the end, you have the same residual dissipation. So this is what you know. This is the plastic power. This is the energy stored by hardening. So there is a minus sign here because not all the plastic power is dissipated. There is a part which is stored by means of dislocations, and that's why you have mindset. And then you have the heat. Okay, so you may say, oh, I don't recognize the high order term disappear. Okay, so let's see how, where they will come in.
So, maybe yes. Comment again with the difference between P and PT, because I think it seems to me that there is a difference. Is there P is PT or not?
No!
So, it is not. Then you comment again on
this. Later, yeah. Later it will be related. Yeah. But at this point, they are independent. P is an internal variable which will be controlled by equation we have to define. Pk is a degree of freedom because there is a gradient in the theory, so this is which is controlled by the balance equation which is here, we see. So they are separated. I have to say nothing about the connection between P and Pk. But I have said a few things. I have said that there are these state laws, so which restrict the situation to non-dissipative Pk variable. Which is a simplification. What?
The temperature should not be the degree of freedom?
Yes, I would consider only isothermal. Yeah. Yes, it's, you could even enhance it also, but this is not the purpose. Yeah.
You are in the linear phase.
Linearized small deformation. Yes. Yeah, but you can do it for large strains. It's simply for the presentation. It's a scalar theory, so it's quite easy to formulate. Okay? So linked to strain gradient plasticity that you know from the literature. One of the most famous models is Eiffentis strain gradient plasticity, because one of the oldest ones, one of the most simple, and the one we will recover with our very simple assumptions. Okay, so what is the assumptions now? It must be always more specific. I must come to the material I want to describe. So these are my choices now of the free energy potential. So we have elasticity standard with Hooke's fourth order tensor. I have to say something about the stored energy by dislocation, by hardening. I take a very simple case and consider the quadratic potential with respect to that. So it means we have a H which is a plastic modulus, and we will describe the behavior like that. If I take sigma, the uniaxial stress, epsilon plastic in the axial direction, the law will be this way. This is the yield stress, sigma zero here, so the elastic regime in vertical here, and then we have a slope here, and this will be H. Okay, so this is very simple construction. Of course, you can do more elaborate. And the new part is what I will do with the PK. This is the most interesting part for us here. First, there is this quadratic form, so I take it quadratic for simplicity. So you see, first choice, quadratic potential, but with special choice of variable. This one is quite standard. You want to penalize. You want to penalize the gradient of microplastic strain. This is my choice. Like Ehringer, he took the quadratic potential and the gradient of chi. Here it's a gradient of pi. This part is quite standard, I would say. This is what you find in most theories. But now comes the coupling between the micro and the standard variables. And this is by means of this coupling term here, which is a quadratic potential again, but which measure the difference between plastic strain, cumulative plastic strain that you know, and this micromorphic value. It's linked. It means that this pKi departs from P, it will cost energy, a lot, because the HKi will be, in fact, a penalty in this way. So now they are linked together. And this is where it comes in. And it's a bit finished, in fact, once you have done this choice. So it's a coupling between the micro and standard function. Okay, then let's look at the consequences. Derivative with respect to elastic strain gives you Hooke's law. Derivative with respect to pKi gives you this equation. So you see that A, the high order stress, is proportional to the difference between P and pKi. Here. Derivative between P B is proportional to the gradient of P-tank, so the generalized Hooke's law, if you want. And you can put tensor of second order because this is a vector. And very interesting part, hardening. The hardening in the standard theory is simply H multiplied by P. But here, due to the coupling, when you take the derivative with respect to P, you have H multiplied by P, yes. But you also have a contribution in the coupling. So you have an additional hardening contribution. This is how the model influences the hardening. Very specific part, does not affect elasticity. Look, there is no change in elasticity, nothing special. But it affects the hardening. So this is the consequence of the choice. Okay? And now you substitute this equation here, this equation here, in the second balance equation that we had, which is A is the divergence of B. Second balance. If you do that, you find this, of course, within the A we have P minus P chi. In B you have something proportional to gradient of P chi, and you have the divergence, and this modulus which comes in. So this is a partial differential equation for P chi. So what will be P chi? It will be solution of this partial differential equation, second order, with the source term, which is P itself. And if you consider isotropy, and we consider isotropy case, A must be spherical, and you can ask confirmation to Nicolas, of course, but since Monday you have, you know, all of this for higher levels. And if you do that, and if you assume the material is homogeneous, then you can put it here, and you end up with this equation, and you see that the characteristic length arises in the theory, because this is dimensionless, this is dimensionless, this also, second derivative, so there must be here the square of a length. So I introduce characteristic length here. Let's call it NC, which is the square root of the higher order modulus divided by this H cap. This is one length coming out in this partial differential equation. We insisted on the fact that when using the method of virtual power, you get the boundary condition easily. This is true. If you look here, I forgot to mention that, of course, you have a boundary condition related to the micro deformation. This is here the Neumann boundary condition. It says that the flux of B can be controlled. Flux of B. And the corresponding Dirichlet condition is that you can fix pi at the boundary, at least theoretically. How you do it experimentally is another story. But at least mathematically, this is the proper condition. So here, if you assume that you have a linear relationship between B and the gradient of pi, you see that the boundary condition looks like that. And in many papers, you find that we propose to regularize the mechanical problem, which has some softening, not some localization, by introducing a partial differential equation like this, which is a diffusion operator, if you want. So it is something smoothing, and you put it there simply as a mathematical tool. And boundary condition, you must say something, and you say, okay, usually you say gradient of the degree of freedom is zero, scalar n is zero. This is what they are saying usually. There's zero everywhere very often, which is not really, if you take subdomain, you should also consider this. So here, this is clearly set, it's not necessarily zero. If you take a cut in the body, it will not be zero, you know, the AC. And if it's at the boundary, it will be zero if it's a free surface, because it's higher the force. So here we don't have to postulate the regularization operator. It comes out as a balance equation, as a result of balance equation. So this is the funny the things in this presentation that you can, based on the formulation of continuum thermodynamics and thermomechanics, you can derive some regularization operators, but for which you know exactly which kind of boundary condition you have. Okay. I found this. Let's specify even more. We go to the full model. You need the yield function, elasticity based on the yield function. So the yield function involves sigma h, which is the von Mises equivalent stress. Okay, sigma h equivalent is the equivalent stress. So we are interested in based on the deviatoric stress tensor. If we take simply sigma h, and you take sigma, double root of sigma, take the deviatory. This is based on plasticity. There is no volume change in the transformation here. So plasticity here induce no volume changes. So I take only the deviatory part as a driving force. Okay. Sigma y, sorry, it was a sigma zero before. Sigma y is the yield stress, initial yield stress. R is the hardening. So the hardening curve is sigma y plus r. So it's not a constant yield stress, it's increasing yield stress. Okay? So the yield function is equivalent stress minus the radius of the elasticity domain. Okay? So now if you we call the dissipation. So really there is an additional term could be kinematic hardening before, because in the limit of the rigid. It was mentioned yesterday, Luca, you mentioned kinematic hardening. Indeed, you can put it, can be there. It's an internal value, so I need this. Okay, so standard plasticity, so this is speed of it, right? This will be speed of. And as you see, this is given by the F, the yield function is a potential for plasticity. It's a potential for plasticity. And so you see that the Lagrange multiplier, the plastic multiplier here, will be speed of.
And these evolution laws are derived how?
I'll explain.
Okay.
Here we have to choose. I mean, this here I did not derive them. I take standard plasticity, so it's based on dissipation potential. The yield function itself can be used as dissipation potential for associated plasticity. And it's not associated, you use another one.
And then another dissipation.
Yeah. So I take really the standard theory. It can be combined because we have the same. We have the same expression for the dissipation. We can add all what you know on the formulation of plasticity. There is no real change in this. The change is here. This is essential in this part. Okay, now let's look at what happens to the stress when you have plastic loading. Since, so under plastic loading, F is zero. You are on rate independent plasticity. You are on the yield surface. You stay on the yield surface. Under plastic loading condition. So what happens? Sigma equivalent is equal to sigma y plus r. So sigma y plus r, r is here. So you have two terms. You have this h plus h, chi p. And you remember that p minus p chi is related to the Laplace of p chi itself by this balance equation. You see that p minus p chi is minus something LC squared to the Laplace. So you can replace in the equation here, and you eliminate P, in fact, here, and you have P chi and gradient and Laplace of P chi. And suddenly, the hardening equation, I mean the yield function, the evolution of the hardening, is a partial differential equation. So this is, if you don't eliminate P, it remains local. But if you substitute the balance equation there, you get a partial chance differential. And this reminds us of Eiffanty's work, because if you look at Eiffanty's work, Eiffanty said, ex abrupto, he said, you add some Laplace term here with a minus sign in front of it. And he insisted on the fact that you must have a minus sign. Yes?
It seems to me that since in the error you have p minus pk, so you have the Laplacian, and finally the Laplacian is contributed to the
No.
Because
no.
You have f b dot.
Yeah, yeah, but it will be eliminated by the constitutive equation b is the derivative of psi with respect to gradient b. So there is no dissipation associated to that. If you substitute everything.
Maybe I still will comment. So it is as if you had hyper stress in the criterion, no?
So it's not in the criterion because you see the equivalent stress is a change.
Yes.
Because you could have invented also an extended theory like this. You could say, that it's done for instance for Kosova theory. You said, okay, I add some L1 square and I take a norm of, for instance, the higher order stress. Do that if you want. And this is what you think of. This is somewhat different because I don't do that. It could be another theory. So, it comes in the hardening. So,
since we are commenting,
yeah.
I think it seems to be very similar to what Benalal and Lois did for damage.
There are some similarities, I think, yes, but they did not introduce a thermodynamic potential for it.
Yes.
They introduced it recently, perhaps, yes. But
no, this is the definitions of.
Perhaps, yeah, yeah. I think it's similar because they implemented it and it's very similar for that. Yeah?
So at this point here, you just have any dissipation related to plasticity?
To plasticity, yes, because there is, of course, dissipation here. No specific one to the p-type itself. And this is constitutive as you can if you need it, but I don't need it because you see here, I recover, I found this, in which way? You simply let h chi go to infinity. And if you let h chi go to infinity, you will force the penalty energy, you will force the p to be equal to the p-chi, the internal constraint. Because if the modulus, the energy becomes very high, it will start try to remain very close to p chi, to p. So you can replace p chi by t, exactly like in micromorphic case. If you take the modulus of Ehringen, which connects the difference between the micromorphic strain and the gradient of displacement, if you let it go to infinity, you go to the constraint that you get the gradient theory. So you see that you recover this equation. Problem with this equation and with the proper sign, because there was a discussion in Ifantis plasticity, I should try with a plus. But it's not good because plus means that our A here is negative, and it means that our potential here, our energy potential, is negative. No, I want convexity. You have stabilization. So this is essential that the A is positive. And so there is no other possibility, or can be, but then you have to work a bit more. To do so. So this motivates, in fact, the choice, of course, I knew that because the solution of the equation must be like that, if you want to regularize localization. But it comes here as a consequence of stability in the potential. Okay, other comment? I did not want to speak about equations, but this is a partial differential equation for p, so it means that the yield function, because the yield gradient becomes a partial differential equation. This is a nightmare, because then you have to look where is the elastic domain, and at the boundary you must look. People have done that. This is a nightmare. Of course, I will not consider this equation. This I did only to see where the coupling with higher order derivative comes in, but I will not solve this. I will take this. This is a local equation, this one. This is a degree of freedom, so if you think of finite element, you have it at the node, so you interpolate it in the interaction point. And V is an internal variable, you solve it by Fermi's plasticity, you solve the evolution of viscoplasticity, you have your equation for P dot, for instance. So it's a local quantity, you don't need to consider the yield function as partial differential equation, and especially, of course, this is for a finite value of h chi. You could imagine to consider it as a Lagrange multiplier, but okay. Okay, let's apply it now to see how it works. I think this is the objective of our meeting in this beautiful room here. First experimental results. What is Luders for your your culture, huh? For those who don't know. Sorry for those who already. This is still for nuclear industry, so it's important. So it's for the pipes of the cooling system, the secondary cooling system. So there are many experiments. They have experiments up to minus 100 degrees Celsius. And what they notice is that the curve is not the standard curve that you find that you like in your theory. It's a strange curve with a peak, look at peak stress, first blood drop, a plateau, and then falling. And then finally fracture. I will not consider fracture anymore in this region, small string. So the Möbius phenomenon is the existence of this plateau and this peak. And you see that if you load at a different temperature, if you decrease the temperature, but of course the stress level increases, you know that, the yield stress increases when you lower the temperature, but the peak stress also becomes very pronounced. The shape of the peak stress, how it decreases, it's completely related to the machine you are using and the setup and the boundary condition and how to fix it, how it is aligned. Taking the values of the maximum and the softening is a softening can forget it. Form the shape of it's not consecutive in some sense, something a structural problem. The peak, if you are lucky, you can have the sort of value there. So this is the reverse phenomenon. Okay, and what happens? For that, nowadays you use strain field analysis to see what happens. You don't touch the sample, take images, correlation. There is a specialist in the room on that doing his PhD on that. Where is he? Must be here. Perhaps we have lost him. No, he's here. Ah, you are here. Okay, he's working on that. Image correlation, much more sophisticated than what is done here, because it's at the macroscopic scale. So you have a cylindrical specimen, and you look on the side, and you have a small strip when you determine the strain distribution. So this is a strain at different steps. So the strain you see is almost zero here, and it's about 1.2% here. And you see what happens? There is a deformation zone which expands and will fill in the full sample, and when it's completely full, then you have increase of the load again, the hardening again. And during the propagation of the two fronts, here are two fronts, front of the band here and here also, you have a sort of plateau, which is typical for propagation of something, and this is a localization band. And you see that the strain inside the band is almost constant, it's always green here, so simply propagate, and after that you will have. Okay, so this is it. Now, if you look at the sample itself, not only the strip, you will see that it's a planar band, and which is inclined with respect to the load. I will come back to that. Okay, so now you plot the strain along the cylinder, so as a function of the action coordinate, and you see at the beginning zero strain here, suddenly you have band here, and you see that the band expands here. Okay, constant strain is a bit deteriorated in the experiment, it's not so constant. It's due to the fact that there is no unicity or uniqueness of the band, you can have zero bands. What happens, you have one band and you have another one on the other plane with the same orientation but rotated, and they intersect and you have more strain locally. That's why you have some bumps. But essentially, you have a given strain here and you have the propagation of the band. So you see the front of the band, something like a sort of smooth curve here. Depends, of course, you have to take care of the resolution of your strain field measurement to have a precision in the front here, and then you fill in the full sample. Okay.
Which is typically the order of magnitude of the relation between the structure outside and the internal magnitude?
Yes, so you see the front here is a few millimeters, and the sample is like that. So it's it's you can see it. You can
not
see
so
it.
Small. I mean,
it's smaller, much smaller, but not so small. Yeah, yeah.
So it is not shear only, it is also elongation.
Of course, because the things like this. It's, we say shear because we you put you imagine the band and you take the coordinate system in the band and then there is a component of shear there.
So locally it is a shear
difference. It's for Mises. Mises is only shear.
Yeah. Well, I will show you the solution in fact. In fact the stress is in the idealized case. Stress is homogeneous, it's tensile stress. But the strain is not homogeneous. Plastic strain is heterogeneous, with the Adamard discontinuity. Okay? So, people in metallurgy have simulated this kind of behavior since 30 years, in the first, perhaps 20 years, the first simulation. So, what they did is, I know what I need for that, I need a softening and then hardening is the main ingredient. And so they take the curve, so they don't take R is a linear function of P, but they take a function like, which is a bit complicated. If you do that and you implement your new nonlinear hardening law in your code, what will happen the following? You load this, you have a sample like that. Let's consider your plane stress, a very simple case here, simulation. Then you increase the load to follow the constitutive law you have put there, but suddenly you have a growth drop, and then you have a sort of plateau with oscillations, and then you have again some hardening. This is what you find in your finite element computation. And I want to convince you that there is some mesh dependence on the simulation. Here you have two meshes. You have a regular mesh, this one, which is nice oscillations. And this one, this is which is a random quadratic mesh. And you see you have some possibility. So you see that plateau, if you have to give a value of so the plateau, it's not so precise, depends on the mesh. And the value of the plateau is important because we have it in the experiment, so we can calibrate the model with that.
So it is the model of the internalite that you have shown previously?
Here, this is the model without internalite. Sorry. This is simply your standard finite element with this function. When you simulate, you get this.
I mean, you have a non-convex function.
Yes.
Plot in what and what?
Between the stress and the plastic strain. Cumulative plastic strain. Sigma and sigma is S as a function of P. Okay. It's a function like that.
Okay.
So it's not this one. It's this one. So it's in fact this one. Even you can put some modeling at the beginning. Here there is a bit of modeling. Look here. There is first modeling and then something. So it would be a bug and then.
Tell me. Is the plateau coinciding with the maximum well?
You killed my last slide. No. So, I mean, of course. Yeah, it does.
He said it be 1 second before me. I've seen his eyes.
Yes, we will determine that. Okay? And now, because people told me, especially Stelios told me last year, no, there is no mesh dependence for this. Because he made many simulations.
So, sorry, but in this kind of model, you have a softening.
Softening, but hardening after.
Hardening, yeah, but you have a region that
yes.
You are softening.
Yes, but in fact, it's true that if you say, okay, well, mesh dependence, it's not so much. Because if you look at the experiment, and it's true that because of the hardening, which instantaneously stabilizes it, it's not so mesh dependent. So you have some effect, I mean, it's quite it. So people usually they take some mesh, random mesh, and they will observe that if you refine, you have no so much changes. Why? Because it's only at the formation of the band,
and then you hit the stability, you go to a strain, and then the.
And you can simulate the plateau quite almost mesh.
But you lose all the spin on that.
Yeah. But we have found an example where mesh dependence is terrible. If you align the cannot show that, but the band is inclined, right, like this. So we have a sample, and for instance here, what you see is that the formation of a red band, red, so it's already a large one, so we have two bands, this one which is bended like this, this one which is bended. And at the front, you see how it happens, you have one row of elements which are uniform, and you see how the band will advance. There is a inclined band. And if you align the elements with the theoretical orientation, because we can show, I will show it later on, you can know the orientation of the band. If you do that, then you obtain this terrible curve, so, where there is no plateau. So I said to Stelios, yes, but you should never align the band to the. Okay, agree, because you have to take care. Because as soon, I mean, this is clear for the people of finite element, they know that. It's clear.
You are a bad boy, you are choosing an element for not having the simulation work.
Exactly. And what happens is really that you, it's very physical, I think. You understand it, in fact, because you say, okay, I have a row of integration points here that you must specify. So first, look, you drop the stress and you go into the minimum. And then you have to pardon again, to go again up to the high stress, so that the next row will also classify. And that's why you get 20 values. And it does not happen if you have random mesh. Why? Because the elements at the boundary, they do not allow their smooth fit because of the regularity. They cannot describe the discontinuity of the strain properly. If you do it parallel to the boundary, the strain can be discontinuous. And so we use it. Okay, so we say it's mesh
dependent. And from the experimental point of view, if you try to stretch a crystal with a lattice exactly in this direction, you have this.
So you don't speak about the true Ludus band, but on the single crystal.
Yeah.
Which is different. It's almost like, it's almost discontinuity. Okay, so if you have a slip line, indeed, if for instance here, you see, you have really a jump of here you have a shear which is by jump, the discontinuity of the strain.
So you see also the oscillation in the plateau?
We don't have the experiment for the single crystal with Ludus. Usually not so clearly. So this is still an open question, in fact. But in the polycrystal, you don't see it. But there is a case where you see it, and it will be the next presentation in forms. If you crush foams, for instance, where you have a sort of plastic localization of the strain in the band, horizontally, that is not inclined, then you see that. Indeed, you have oscillation and it's like the end. Yes. Okay, so now I introduce the strain gradient model to regularize, I would say, simply. But we will not only regularize, we will calibrate also the length with the experiment. How? So these are the simulation with the gradient model, and you have a very clear plateau, which is always the same, and which you fulfill the Maxwell rule, and does not depend on the mesh. You have some, if you look regular, fine regular, random, oriented, you have some artifacts, but if it's fine enough, if the mesh is fine enough compared to the Curtis length, then you reach mesh independence. This is what happens, and then the front of the band is a bit thick. So it's not simply one row of integration points, but there are several elements.
Yeah. You mean that somehow do you have an initial defection in your simulation?
In this case, you don't need, because there is this stress concentration, so usually it starts there, due to the bone shape of the sample. So we don't need imperfection. Then put one. Usually, and it's true, the experiment very often starts at the grips, but not always, because in the example I gave you of the field that I started in the middle. So it's something you cannot really predict. Okay, and this is the field along the strain, along the vertical line of the sample, and you see the localization, and you see the propagation of the field. Because as soon as you have localization, materials hardened, and then it stopped to deform, and the next will deform. This is why you have localization, but then you have propagation. If you don't have this branch, if you simply go softening, of course it will never stop, and this is what is called fine localization. When it will localize to infinity. And this you need to regularize, and this model can do that, in fact. I will give you this solution. And this, you see what we did, we calibrated the thickness of the front from the strain field analysis, simply. Because there we see that it's a few millimeters, so we calibrate the length by an identical solution, so that we have the same, about the same bound front. Yes?
What is it propagated in what direction?
It's still an instability, yeah? There is, you regularize, but it does not mean you have uniqueness of the solution. The solution is not unique. So it depends on that case. If you, of course, if you do twice the simulation with the same mesh, the same code, and the same parameters, you get the same. But if you change the mesh, if you modify, if you change the computer, you may have differences. Because it's an instability. So for the analytical solution, I have not taken such a complicated function here. I have taken a bilinear function. So you have softening, and then you have hardening. So this is a complicated case, more than this one, because you have a softening branch. For this, I will get the analytical solution. That's why you consider. And on this curve, you have several quantities. You have the maximal stress here, which will be the peak stress. It will be the maximum peak stress at the beginning. You have the PL, which is the lunar strain. This is the end of the plateau in the experiment, where the sample, where the deformation is homogeneous. So you can get it in the experiment. So it means in the experiment I get this, this and the plateau stress also. And then this is in the modeling. In fact, it's not very important. You simply need softening. But to identify exactly this value, there is no unique, no easy determination of this, unless you have more information on the mechanism. So we choose simply one value, so steep, so anyway, of course we looked a bit at the peak, but it's not exactly the shape of the unloading, so we cannot really get that. So we have two moduli, one negative H1, one positive H2. Okay. Then you look at, you consider what is the orientation of the band. I will not recall it because this is the same analysis as in classical plasticity. It's a bifurcation analysis which tells you is it possible to have a band of deformation along which you have a discontinuity of the strain tensor. Of course, the strain tensor you must have some can be discontinuous. You know that, but there must be some. Constraint, because of course tangential conditions, the field is the same, the same limit on both types of displacement, so the derivative along the band, along the line on the front is known. So you cannot be discontinuous. So you take that to this Adamard condition. So this gives you the shape of the jump. If you do that, and if you say, okay, tensile test, band like this, more strain in one band, and I apply the Adamard condition, you find that there is only one possibility for von Mises plasticity. It must be with, for von Mises because it's without volume change. If you take volume change, you will change the angle. So you get the famous angle 45 degrees. So the orientation is, this is from a classical analysis, no gradient, nothing. And the gradient does not change anything because this is a beginning. Is the solution is homogeneous. So at the beginning, it should start, it can evolve after, but at the beginning, it's like, only for your information and for the next talk after. If it is a compressible medium, so if you don't use von Mises, but if you use a compressible medium, for instance, the case of a foam where the plastic Poisson ratio is zero, can have this special microstructure where it's possible, then the band is horizontal. You can prove it easily by its criterion. If you have a bit of change of contraction, then it will, can have continuity between von Mises to the horizontal band. And in foam, indeed, we find horizontal band. Okay, so this is the orientation of the band. And what is interesting in this solution, it's very pure, because it's pure tension. the stress is homogeneous. Stress tensor is homogeneous. All along, it's transferred, the stress vector, it's transmitted along. So you have to fulfill the transmission of the traction vector at the boundary of the band, of course. But the plastic strain is not homogeneous. You have a high value in the band, zero or something before, in the in outside. So it's a very nice solution, well known, of course. But now if you apply the gradient theory, you will not have a line of discontinuity because, of course, if you have a jump in the strain, you will have a jump in the plastic strain. And in the theory, you think of strain gradient plasticity, so we need a bit more continuity. So, especially, the pi must be continuous because we take its gradient. So, at least we should require its continuity. And so it must be also derivative. We can take the derivative. So, pi cannot jump from the band to the outside. So, this will be reflected by the following. Okay, this is the axis along the band here. This is the part here where you have no plastic strain because the band did not come there. This is the right here, so there is no plastic strain here. Here, this is the part behind the band, so the band has propagated. So there is a saturated value of the plastic strain. And in between, there is a front of the band, and we want to describe the front of the band which has a finite thickness. So let's look at the condition. At the beginning here, we are in the front zone, so the stress was very high at the peak stress, and suddenly decreases. So if it decreases, first you are in the softening region. So the front band, here the front of the band, here in the region with H1, which was negative. Okay. And behind, it's overcome, you reach the minimum, and then you go up again, and you are in the part where H2 is positive. Because the stress is uniform, because of equilibrium, so you can be here, or you can be here. And this is what happens. Okay. So now we take the equation of Martin, the U1. So this is simply the softening branch. It's H2, which is, oh no, this is Martin one. H2 is positive, and this is the equation here, with an affine Martin here. And this is the gradient term right from this. For the solution, if I don't give you the solution for the micromorphic solution, but for the limit, where HK is very large, so the gradient. So it's P, which is here. Well, yeah, of course, we can also work around the solution for PK, it's possible. And here I show you the strain gradient plasticity gains. Okay, so this is the sigma plateau here. It's, in fact, it's uniform, so the derivative is zero. So you can take the derivative of this. This is constant. Derivative of the strain, plastic strain, this is constant, this is zero. And here you have the third derivative. So you have the third derivative, first derivative, and you look at the coefficient. So we have three, so we have to write this. We have to write it here. To be sure that it's a proper sign, I think there is an error in the slide. I think this one. Okay. So we have third derivative of P is equal to so H2 divided by, if I am wrong or not, okay, divided by, please help me. I take the spatial derivative of the first equation. I get that the A P second becomes P third, okay, divided by A, multiplied by five. So this is the differential equation to solve. It's an easy one. What is essential here is sign of this. Okay? It's a sign of this. Here, H2 is the hardening branch. So H2 is positive. A is positive because of convexity. And so the solution is it's solution of the equation, which kind of function? Exponential function. Exponential function. Or cosinus hyperbolic. So that's wrong what I have written here, was to see if you follow the course. It's of course the exponential branch. So it's exponential with a characteristic length, which is L2. Okay? And you see this is a cosine hyperbolic. So cosine hyperbolic like this. You find with the boundary condition. We have this part. If it is, it must be almost flat, and this is a cosine hyperbolic. Now, if you replace this by H1 here, for the same equation, take H1, but H1 is negative. So then the solution is not exponential, it's harmonic. Okay? So, with a characteristic length, where you have a minus because H1 is negative. It's perfect. And you get a sinus branch. So it means that this branch here is an arc of sinus function. It's an arc of sinus function. So now you have to connect all this. What are the connection, the interface condition? So the interface condition in this theory is, comes from the theory, continuity of pi here. At the limit, it's continuity of P itself, because we are at the limit. And transmission of the higher order stresses. Because there's a B scalar N must also be there. And this is conditioned on the first derivative of P. So you have, indeed, that it must be flat here. And here you must have the same tangent. Because the A parameter is the same on each side of the interface, same material. So you have the same tangent. There is a very smooth front which connects the cosinus hyperbolic to the sinus branch. And this is what your description, very simple, of the front. And okay, so we can identify the parameters from the measurement, because after that, we get the shape. This is the rate. So you have the shape of the front zone. And this you can compare with spring. Okay, so stress plateau, how do you determine it, in fact? It, indeed, you use Maxwell rules, in fact, for that. What does it mean? It means, practically, that when you are here, the material is again homogeneous. The formation is homogeneous again, because the matter went through, and the full summary is homogeneous. So now, if you think, you have two possibilities, at least, to reach this point. One possibility is you follow the unstable path. So you go there. All the samples, the homogeneous, and you follow this. Of course, if you breath too much, we have that. But if you are lucky, you are on the instable branch. Okay? So then you will get some energy. All this energy. The part is dissipated. I have not taken this because I have taken a calculation where this part is depends what you choose for plastic dissipation, depends on the choice of internal variable to here. And that was here below the plastic, initial plastic. Then you can take it from the then it's full plastic work. And because the axis is still the other possibility is that you have the band which progresses. So non-homogeneous solution. And this is this constant stress, because you have constant stress. But at the end, this is the same from the point of view of energy. Why? Because what is the difference for the material volume element? There is one difference. The stress level explored are the same, if you want, huh? But the strain rate is not the same. Because if you localize, the strain rate is much larger than if the sample deforms homogeneously. So the strain rate is different, okay. But the model I have used is rate independent. So it does not affect the period. So the energy consumed at the end is the same. So that's right, you can equate both and find the value of the data. And this is essentially Maxwell. But if the material is viscoplastic, this is not true. So we have to rethink what it can be in that case, how to find. And the material, the actual one, of course, is viscoplastic, so you're a bit. The plateau is not so well defined. But if you take rate independent, you can find exactly what your finite element are. Fine. Okay, and I think this is the right time to stop.
Okay, for thank you. A commentary for the coffee break.
Yeah.
I think Pierre has the same feeling. This is very similar to phase transition. We should find.
Of course, this is a phase transition, yeah.
But you, this is irreversible.
Yeah, this is irreversible, yes.
So it's something like surface tension, boundary layers, phase, different phases.
I forgot to tell why it's like that, what is the phase transformation behind. In fact, this is this interaction between dislocations and solute atoms of carbon, because it's still. And or can be also the atom of nitrogen. They are fixed on the dislocation, and when you want to make it, they make them move, they are pinned by the atoms. So the dislocation bows out like this and tries to escape the solute atom, and suddenly it breaks, and the dislocation moves, and it's an avalanche. So it's an instability avalanche. So it's
so this is the
micromechanism.
Okay, so I hope we find.
Yes? Yeah? Yeah? So I had a good example on P and its derivative. First derivative, which I took zero because it was a part where you have no deformation. And the other one, when we have the deformation is constant, so D is not zero, the derivative is zero. On one side, on the other side, it's finished. You will not have further, but before you start again, how do you
know? I would like the demographical design.
Do you want to pass it
bigger? Oui, mais je peux faire une petite technique, la solution est très jolie. Il y a une solution pareil, quoi.
Hein?
Voilà, tu peux la faire. D'ailleurs, je peux la montrer tout à l'heure, celle-là.
Oui, non, ah oui. Okay. Somebody has
lost. Yes, but it was a bit too fine. I could not really. But
German people! Congratulations! Yeah. Italy is destroying your position. Okay, the mayor of the city should show up, but he will stop when he arrives, okay?
Okay.
Go ahead.
So, I am not sure I will have enough.
Salve, buongiorno. Io parlo tutte le lingue, però preferisco parlare nella mia lingua madre che è l'italiano. Io faccio io. Allora, per chi mi chiede tu sai parlare? Allora, mi traduci. Allora, per tutto devo chiedere scusa per il disguido di stamattina.
No, ma questo è... Almeno 50%.
Ce lo devi dire la colpa di chi
è?
No, no. Te la sorpresa lì. No, perché ha fatto un comunicato dicendo che...
Okay. In misunderstanding of the door opening, okay, I will not translate.
E quindi do il benvenuto perché ecco, siamo fieri di ospitare questo convegno matematica. E ringrazio il mio professore per aver scelto questa città. Noi siamo veramente quindi, onorati di averti qui. Ah, ci avete la lavagna come vecchi testi, quindi
è anche
un bel piacere. E poi il quindi ha colorato un po' con loro questo di citazione.
Sì.
Allora, con loro,
no, lui è parigino e Goldemino. Tedeschi.
Quale è usato in inglese?
Inglese.
Ok, buon lavoro. Buon gioco.
Good job.
Good job.
Thank you very much.
Please, go on.
So next time you make the powder compact, you break the foam, then you cannot collect properly the current. So it's important that the material is ductile. So you should not break the struts. And in fact, the struts are these beams here. Probably when you deform it, you should not break too much. Okay. Constitutive model. As I said before, I have a starting point, which is a classical approach of engineer, very standard. And I will add only, I will plug only at the end the gradient tool, toolbox. So first, we try to model this product. You see, this is a coil of foam. This is 1 meter here. And the set size is 0.5 millimeter. The material is processed by coiling. There is a heat treatment, so you pull a bit on it to deform the cell. So the material is anisotropic, strongly. And I can say that the cells are something like ellipsoids with different axes. So I have a sort of rolling direction, transverse and normal direction, which is very important. The source of anisotropy is also the fact that it's a polyurethane foam. So you have a liquid polymeric foam, so you have some drainage, and then you have some gravity-induced anisotropy also, because then you make some cuts. So you have two sources of anisotropy. The result is that it's anisotropy. We will represent it by strongly plastic, I'll show the curve. And I use very simple model. I use Hill model, but if Albrecht Bertrand would still be there, he would tell me there is a paper of von Mises giving the anisotropic plasticity in 28, I think in the same paper as for isotropic case, because it starts from the anisotropic and then make the von Mises criterion. So let's say Hill von Mises criterion. So you take the deviatoric part still, but here you have not the identity matrix, but we have different terms. Depending on the orientation. So there is a fixed frame attached to the material, rolling, transverse. So, in plasticity, but the foam is compressible. I mean, if you, it's not like von Mises, so when you pull it, the volume changes. I mean, what I call volume is the box containing the cells. So the box changes. So, I put the trace. Its identity, it is a trace of the stress. So it's a quadratic elliptic criterion, which is well known in soil mechanics. People in soil mechanics use Drucker-Prague, or they use elliptic, which is nice elliptic because it's more regular. Elliptic, so if you take one with S here, H one, is one, is exactly the elliptic criterion in compressible plasticity in soil mechanics. But here it's anisotropic, so I change the invariant. And here I have this matrix, and here I use another invariant, also with a weighted trace, if you want. And these parameters, there is not really parameters, I will identify in a phenomenological way, as done usually. Plasticity, flow rule, plastic multiplier, stress, the yield function, stress, and then you take the yield function is here, with the radius here, take the derivative. You see that you have a part which is, can be deviatoric if you take the derivative part. H multiplied by the same deviatoric, so you have a derivative part. Plus this one which is the compressible part. Yes?
We have a specific body side look like here, because it's like porous, as you mentioned, geometry.
Yes, exactly. Our experience in phones. Aluminium foams, metallic foams, and nickel foams, is that the normality is enough. Indeed, with the experiment, with multi-action, In fact, it fails when there is contact between the struts. If you compact it and then you have contact with the struts, then probably the criterion will not work. But as long as you don't have this internal friction, you don't really need non-associative. And it works very fine. This is also shared by many people. If you look in HP's books, also they notice that. Sorry? Yeah? You can do compression along the normal because you will have bubbling. It's a thin, you have seen it's a coil, so it's a thin plate, and then to compress it's difficult, but you can compress it along the normal direction. Then you have a squeeze of the. You have a difference in the behavior. It's true, the stability are different. Because it's nice with this product, usually foam you compress them, but here I can pull on it because it's a plate. But it's true, if you want to describe properly in compression, you have to take care of the localization mode. Yeah?
H here should be a matrix of mass and size because we work on the space of the
Yes. There is a relation. The formula of. Okay, consistency condition. Young's modulus, hook tensor, strain, because we will consider softening. And you know, for softening, you cannot use the consistency condition with the stress rate. Because if you have softening, you cannot control the stress, you have a bifurcation there. So we control the strain rate, in fact. So you take the formula of plasticity condition with strain rate. You have Hooke's tensor, and here you have the derivative of hardening with respect to the plastic strain. It's negative if you have softening. And we will see we'll have hardening and then softening. So it can be negative, it should not be too much negative, because then you have a sort of snapback and it's complicated. Okay. We'll go to fracture, in fact, at the end, we'll see that. So I take here, I take a very simple law, linear part, exponential part, simply to have a nice curve, like in the experiment, phenomenological. Okay, experimental results. Tensile tests, one along the rolling direction, this one, and one along the transverse direction. So you see, it's 1 megapascal, the order of magnitude of the stress that can be supported by this foam. It's 95% air and still 1 megapascal. Not so much, but still it's a good material. Strongly anisotropic, factor 2. In the stress level, the transverse direction is much softer. The model can do the job, okay, well, quite correctly. So you identify the many constants there, but it's not enough two curves to identify all these parameters. So what we have also, we have the measurement of the lateral contraction and the thickness reduction. This we can measure. And with this, you can identify the various coefficient of the matrix here, because of course the anisotropy of plastic strain is hidden here. In fact, so you need a stress measurement, but a strain measurement also, transverse strain. And then you can check if it works at 45 degrees, because you can cut a sample Okay, so we have values, very anisotropic. You see the trace is not so much a trace anymore, because it's not 1, 1, 1. Okay. Now, the regularization I will use. You will see why I need the gradient. I will explain you. This is what I want to tell you. But I show you the model. This is a micromorphic model of Ehringen. What I will use, but a simplified one. I don't take the full chi, but only a symmetric chi. So this is what I call the microstrain continuum. So the microstrain is here, so you have U, a symmetric second order tensor, symmetric in contrast to Ehringen, so it means that the rotation are not so important, in fact. And then I have the strain measure, you remember, if you think of the first course you had here, P minus P chi, here is epsilon minus chi symmetric. So it's really like Ehringen in that case, simplified a bit, but not 9 degrees of freedom. Here you would have 9 chi ij, here you have only 6. So the total number of degrees of freedom is 9, because you have 6 plus 3 displacement. Okay? So this is well, elasticity. I don't give you the full thermodynamics, the same as before. I give the results. Hooke's law with plasticity here. Linear relationship, this is what I call the relative stress, because it's if you want the price to pay for the microstrain to differ from the macroscopic strain. So if the difference is very strong, this will be very high. And you have the gradient of the microstrain, which is a third order tensor. Okay, so really we use the full theory here. We have only one parameter, so Nicolas will be will say, what is it? You need at least 160 parameters. It's true, I must confess, it's true. I should have introduced here a sixth order tensor, but I am pragmatic. I have taken an identity sixth order tensor. Okay, only one parameter. Okay, the same here. I should have used a fourth order coupling tensor, penalty term, fourth order tensor as a penalty, but I take a spherical one, identity one, only one parameter. So we have two parameters, like in the first model. I have to identify the parameters at the end. Okay. I have two equations. They are a bit different from what I have shown, A equal divergence of B, because now it's a strain which is here, so it's not the plastic one. So you have a coupling between both balance equation, in fact. So you have the stress working with the strain, usual one, and the one working with the relative strain here, and the third order stress, which is the hyperstress or double stress that you discussed, similar to the one in second gradient theory, and you have a coupling by this relative strain. In fact, this is simply renaming some stresses in the power, right? Because you see that you have epsilon here, of course, appearing. Okay, so these are two balance equations. The yield condition that I use, in fact, is not this one, because I don't use dissipative higher order term, as I did before. No change in the classical plasticity. So I will not use De Bort's criterion. Well, I could do that, but I would not do it. And now what I do is I substitute this here and this one here, and I get this equation, which is, again, a diffusion equation for the microstrain tensor. And people reading the literature on damage and plasticity, they know the work done in the Netherlands by Geers, Peerlings. This is the same equation that they postulate and introduce. But here is derived from the constitutive setting. And there is a difference, which is in the hardening law that I mentioned earlier, and there is a coupling in the hardening law that I discussed with PKI. So I will not say that again. Boundary conditions, the same as, they are very simple in contrast to higher grade theory. The boundary conditions are very simple. They are of the Cauchy type, in fact. Simply stress by the normal and higher order stress by the normal, and you have to control that because it's a first gradient theory. Okay, the first question I want to address is a philosophical question. I think you have, this week we had a lot of philosophy. You have noticed that, all of you, I'm sure. Again, a bit of philosophy. What is a hole in a foam? This is the question I am asking. You will say, it depends on the size of the hole. Exactly. If you have the plate and you bore some huge hole with a diameter which is 100 times the unit cell, it's a big hole, it's a hole, it's clear. So, but if the size of the hole reduces, then it's 1 centimeter, then you have 5 cells inside, and then smaller, you can cut. We did it
we took the foam and then we made hole in the foam with emporte-pièce, I don't know how you stamp it, simply by stamping. And until we made very small hole, 1 millimeter, 2 cells. And then we said, is the material weaker because it has this small hole? And we have made experiments for that. You must imagine that the material is a random material. You have seen the foam is a random material. It has a sort of ideal morphology of the unit cell, of the polygon cell, but polyhedron, but it's random distribution. So the hole with 2 cells is something like a bit more random cell. And so the question, what is the impact? And can you model the impact on by the continuum approach? Because if you take a hole of one with the same size of one cell, then you have done nothing special, it should not weaken the material. Is the model able to reproduce that? This is a question that I want to ask. So experiment first. Experiment on the foam. So standard, as I told you, we pull on the foam like this. It's a strip of foam like this. Thickness of the sheet is 3 millimeter. So you have 3-4 cells in the thickness. And then you measure the extension like this, but also we measure also the contraction and also the lateral one to have the information we mentioned. And we can compute some plastic Poisson ratio if you want to calibrate the model. Okay, so this is a standard curve. But then we go to strain field measurements to measure the field, the strain field along the specimen. So we use the same technique as in the morning. Okay. Image correlation, digital image correlation, as you know. Okay. And then this is what we find. So we have the sample here, 2% overall straining, and this is the field. So we are here. So you see, it's not completely homogeneous. There is a sort of fluctuation. I mean, when you believe that your test in the lab provides you homogeneous strain, it's only because you did not look at it. But if you look at it, you will see that strain is not so homogeneous as you imagine. And it is all the more the case when you have a foam, because the foam is a bit random material with the size of the cell is not so small. It's 0.5 millimeter. The thickness here is a few centimeters. So it's not so small, so you have fluctuation. But okay, you can define an effective behavior. We see it here. Okay, and then at the end, you will see a bit, and then it breaks. Okay. So this is the measurements that we have. And now the question is, if you put a hole inside. So we have a hole here. So you see, the boundary is not perfect, of course. Huh? Yeah. This is what tells you continuum mechanics. So we have stress concentration here. And probably it will break, starting from here, of course, we imagine. And this is what the measurement tells you. This is a field, so there are fluctuations. Huh? Quite. But indeed, for large holes, this one, which is a large one, indeed, we find something which is not so bad compared to the continuum mechanics. So this is a continuum mechanics with standard plasticity, the one we discussed with Hill model. Yeah. Okay, and then these are precisely the comparison of the strain and experiment and computation. So experiment here, of course, more strain close to the hole, and then we increase the overall strain, and this is the experiment, and this is the simulation. So the experiment has a lot of noise for many reasons, also the structure of the foam itself, but must say that the continuum model is excellent. The classical continuum model is excellent for this kind of cell where you see 5 millimeter hole diameter. So I would say this is a continuum, this foam, at this scale. If you accept the oscillations, which are intrinsic or noise, it's difficult to say. Okay? Now decrease the hole. So here, for instance, what is this one? 2 millimeter. And so larger hole here, smaller hole, 2 millimeters. Yeah? So, of radius, so 4 millimeter. Still it works, not so bad. Yeah. And then you take one with 1 millimeter radius, so 2 millimeter, and then you have. It's not, the camera is not able to see that there is a hole, in fact, simply, because the fluctuation are come on the order of magnitude. But the continuum model tells there is a hole. It's clear. Because the plate is almost infinite, so there is no effect at all. It's a hole. With a strong concentration of strain, it's plasticity. So large, at the boundary, you can have large strains. Okay. So what we have noticed is that if you use the microstrain model of Ehringen, here it's, I think it's, if you use the micromorphic model coupled with the plasticity in the same way as in the first course, in fact, we note the following. We compute with finite element the hole problem, and you see that, of course, we have more, for large holes, we have more plasticity. This is a classical solution. This is Ehringen solution for large hole, very similar. And this is a solution for a smaller hole, in fact. And you know, for this, I have only two parameters. I have the A and the B. I call it HKI in the morning. Here it was a B, it's a penalty term. Essentially, there is one length, one characteristic length. So we find numerically that when the hole becomes of the order, hole size becomes of the order of the intrinsic length, then the stress, the strain concentration is dramatically reduced, and we can even show numerically that it goes to one. So there is no concentration at all. So you kill, because the price of the gradient would be so large that it becomes invisible. And that's how I identify the constants. The characteristic length of the model was in. I fix the B because it's a penalty, so I fix a value. And I measure, if you want, the characteristic length, which is related, of course, to the cell size here, so that I have no effect or something effect compatible with the experiment for a hole with 1 millimeter. So that's way too. So it solved the philosophical problem. So you see here. The effect of this is a strain concentration at the whole equator. Yeah, you see a classical solution plasticity, very large strain, and here you see that you reduce and even almost constant strain here in the whole sample. If you continue smaller and smaller, you get almost with the line here, which means that the strain is homogeneous, although you have a hole in the geometry. Okay, so this is reminiscent of one use of higher order media, which the objective was to remove singularities and concentrations. There is a paper of Minglin on the strain concentration around the hole in a coupled stress medium, so Kosora medium, where the rotation is equal to the material rotation. So a sort of second gradient, but only part of it. Yeah. And he gave an analytical solution, and he finds that there is still a concentration for the coupled stress theory. But here we have a higher order theory, we have a full strain tensor, and it's enough to kill the concentration. Yeah. Yeah.
Plastic,
because it's so soft, it's only plasticity here. Yeah. But the computer, well, the argument of Minling is in elasticity. But here I use it for plasticity. You see, I plotted the total strain here on the axis. It's very large because it's plasticity. Yeah? Yes, yeah. This is there. Sorry?
It is
there because if you look at the plasticity model, the standard one, it's really the standard one. If you go there, if you look at this here, the plastic power will be sigma double quadratic with special P dot. And it, of course, you can make it in the form of the product sigma equivalent multiplied by a P dot, the plastic multiplier. And you will see that the P dot is an equivalent strain. You know, in von Mises case, in the von Mises case, the P dot is simply conjugate to the stress, in fact, so equivalent stress. So you have, let's say, P dot is square root of 2/3 of epsilon P. Okay? And here, the equivalent stress is not von Mises, it's Hill. So you can also define a P dot which is anisotropic. So the P dot itself contains anisotropy, the one contained in the H matrix, P matrix. Because of normality, yes. Yeah, exactly. So you have this dissipation. After that, you have to consider how much from this is stored. Then depends on your constitutive model. Then, because we need measurement to know how much is stored, in fact. So there is anisotropic dissipation here. Okay? I agree with you that this is a philosophical problem, but if you compute a component, a plate, and we have holes of different size, and you want to compute the system, then you will have different answers of the holes, in fact. The larger one be more dangerous, even if the plate is infinite, in fact. So this is it can have some structural application. But this is not the most important. It's more the point is more the strain concentration, which is smoothed by the higher order theory. Okay? So we identify this. Okay, now the practical application, which is more relevant for the application, is the crack propagation, in fact, the fracture of the foam, because they want to know when it's broken, in fact. Because the ductility of the foam is a limiting factor for the design, in fact, of the batteries. I will do a very simple fracture model with one, no damage variable, nothing, very simple, introducing softening. And you will see it's enough for this kind of material. So what we have done is the following. We have noticed that the tensile curve is like that for this foam. It breaks quite abruptly. So it's hardening, and then suddenly it breaks, quite suddenly. And you see it's not like dense nickel or steel, where you have necking and then shear bending, and so you have really a nice curve that you can follow with at the end the fracture. Here it's a bit more brittle. Why? Because the struts see very large stresses. Even if the macroscopic stress is not so high, there are in the struts many stresses, so it breaks quite early, in fact. So it's a material which is not so ductile as we may expect. So look, 10%. When you imagine that it's 95% air and you still have only 10% extension, it's a bit disappointing. And this is a problem, yeah, for this, for the foams, for the metallic foams. If you do it with a polymer foam, you can extend it much more, of course. Okay, so we considered a very simple fracture criterion, which was, okay, so if you reach 8% strain, then we introduce softening. So we change the function, which was linear and a bit of exponential, and we then add some softening branch. So it's a very simple model, which has only one value, which is P, and we say that there is some critical value where softening quite rapidly starts.
Can you give an idea of an unloading curve?
Unloading? Yeah. If you unload here, for instance, if you unload, then you get this. So it's really plastic. The elastic strain is very small in that case. Okay, but you may say, well, perhaps your model is too simple. Everybody knows that critical strain is not a good criterion for fracture of materials. It could be too easy. But strangely enough, in this case, which is a bit of poor material, you may say, okay, you have tested it in direction of load of rolling direction, but if you try in transverse direction, can you predict the fracture strain? Because here I have fitted this quantity, so I say from this curve, and using the anisotropic version of this, I can make a prediction for the fracture, because it's valid for the P equal to 8%, but it's not this one. You have H minus 1 and all these anisotropy terms there. So you can predict what happens in the other direction. And it works. It works. We have it here. This is a transverse direction. You see that the fracture strain is 15%. So we retrieve the factor 2 that we had on the stress, on the strain, in fact, because the transverse direction is twice more ductile as the rolling direction. And the factor 2 comes from the anisotropy coefficient. So it means that, okay, it's not the most physical criterion you can imagine, but it's not so bad. There is, in some sense, a sort of limiting strain that the cell can accommodate. After that, it breaks. Simply, the struts are destroyed. Okay, so we use that. Here, you see that you have an elastic unloading, because the extensometer, the fracture did not take place within the extensometer branches. So you have a crack here, and the extensometer measures some unloading, but in fact it's broken, because you should have a curve like this if you are lucky, and that the crack is within the extensometer branch. Okay, so this is our tensile model. You see that what is not good in our model is the branch here, which is very slow fracture, so slow turning. In reality, it breaks more rapidly. But we don't see it on the curve because it's unloading this one, so we exaggerate a bit. Okay. The softening is not straight enough. Okay, now that we have the model, the softening model of plasticity, can we predict crack propagation? So we take a foam, and instead of putting a hole, we put a crack. So we have the crack here. This is the foam. So we take a cutter, and then we put the foam in the crack in the foam. And then you have the crack propagation. Look at the crack propagation. This is a boundary. So it's a very complex process of damage and fracture there. You see a bit the ligament of a Barenblatt model, for instance. You may imagine some cohesive zone model for that. It would be interesting. I don't use that, much something more simple in some sense. Okay, and we try to simulate it. We take the softening model, we put a crack. Here there is a crack. And then we pull like this. And due to the softening, puff, we have localization of strain. And now there is no subsequent ordering, there is no propagation, it's broken, it goes to infinity, the strain, it's localization. So we have a crack propagation in the model. But look, the curve is not very nice. And the curve is this one, and the experiment is this one. So we don't predict very well. But in fact, it's due to the fact that we have a mesh dependence. If you change the mesh, this is a classical model, and this is simply the softening and the hill plasticity. No gradient yet, no microstrain yet. And you can find a mesh size which works. It's possible. You can adapt the mesh size to have a... But then you know that if you compute another sample, it will not work. So if the mesh is very small, you have a very brittle fracture, too early, much too early. And if the mesh size goes to zero, you will have a instantaneous breaking. So this is a usual problem of localization in and fracture in conventional softening materials. Okay? Now we use the regularized model with the microstrain with the same length that I have identified, you know, on the hole effect, hole size effect. So I don't use another length. Probably it's not the same length for fracture as for plasticity, but I use the same, because it's the order of the cell size, so it's not bad. And we get this field here, which is mesh independent. I think they have some picture. So it's a non-local zone, which is a bit similar to the picture we had in the size of the experiment here. This is a sort of damage zone here, which is a bit similar. So we reproduce, in some sense, this the size of the damage zone. Okay, and this is the mesh size effect. There is no mesh size effect in that case. Huh? So the zone, the plastic zone size is the same, except if your mesh is too coarse. If your mesh is too coarse, then it's not good, because the size of the element should be sufficiently smaller than the characteristic length of the medium, of course. You have to take care of that. But if you have two elements, I mean, we'd say it's enough to get the first order of your results. Huh? It's enough. That's why I still use sometimes the one of the on the right. Okay, the crack extension is a bit underestimated, but it's not bad. Okay, and now the effect on the curve of the number of nodes, if you so you see you have a convergence in the softening. It's not really like the experiment, because now our softening branch is not very good. It should do something better, but it's not so bad. This is, but you know, when you put the crack, you have to think if you want to put along the rolling direction or along the transverse direction, because there is anisotropy of plasticity. Probably there is anisotropy of cracking also. So then the next stage is to consider the other test. So this one, so what is this one? So let's have a look. I don't remember which one it is. 1 megapascal. So here it's less. So this was a tension along rolling direction. So we identified the softening on this direction, and then we predict the crack. We predict this. This is a prediction. This with the characteristic length that we had before. And we have not changed the characteristic length. It's the same. And then we predict also the fracture of in the other direction. Okay, we overestimate a bit. But it's not so bad. It depends how you cut the crack. It's not so. So the anisotropy is large. Huh? You see the if we have taken the same gauge length. So you see it's twice more ductile along this direction. So it's always this factor 2 which emerges in stress and strain, in fact. Okay? So this is one possibility to apply a higher order theory and the full micromorphic theory, microstrain theory. I would say if I had to, this is a work of the which was done in 2006 about. If I had to reconsider it now, I would take simply the model in the morning with only one parameter, one degrees of freedom, not the full strain, because it's quite long to compute this, and I think I could get very close results. So what is essential is to have here at least one length, even though the material is anisotropic, because we may imagine you need two lengths, perhaps it's better with two lengths or anisotropic length, probably. But it's enough to capture the anisotropy of a fracture, even if your higher order gradient part is isotropic. So this is something for the practice. You don't need to put the full, most complicated one, which I believe this 10 years ago. I wanted to put the full micromorphic, full gradient, higher order gradient. Very good. But we can be a bit more pragmatic and say, oh, add exactly the degree of freedom you need to have some cheaper model, in fact. Huh?
The conclusion should be quite difficult about blocking. You may experience blocking of all those variables,
I get the same problem that you have in conventional plasticity. Because, which is not here.
Micromorphic also, because then we have the gradient of the strain, and then we
have. I have the gradient of independent degrees of freedom. So, if the penalty is too high, you are right, then I get problems, because.
The penalty is not so high, and then.
It's not so. Okay, you may have some fluctuation. It would be good to develop new elements, perhaps, but. It's not so. I get similar results as in conventional plasticity, where already you may have some checkerboard because of plasticity, and this is similar. But it's true, if I increase the penalty term, it's not so good. Then I should use a Lagrange multiplier, really, to have the full, and then probably it's complicated. But with this version of, I would say this micromorphic version is quite cheap, I would say. It's not so. I use quadratic element. With reduced integration, in fact. So less gross point, like in conventional plasticity. There are two possibilities you can consider, because I discretize the new degree of freedom with the same nodes as the displacement. But you could do quadratic for the displacement and linear for the higher order degrees of freedom. It's possible. We test both. There are reasons for both possibilities, because there is no real test for that, because you compare an interpolated value with an internal variable value, and then there is no real reason. And there is no real change if you use one. Of course, if you use quadratic linear, you have less additional degrees of freedom for the model. It's better. But the problem is the non-linearity, the softening, and the integration of... So, There we have problem of integration of the constitutive equation, really. This is a non-linearity which is very strong in the zone of quark propagation, for instance. So the number of degrees of freedom is not really the problem. Even if you use the full micromorphic, this is, the problem is integration of the non-linear softening constitutive equation. This is very stiff, and this is a problem. We have still problem. I mean, this not like you have it, you program it, and then it's finished with fracture, you have it. It's not really like that. You have problems with the softening. Should not be too softening, because convergence is very bad. This is implicit computing. Yeah? Okay. So you have to struggle. Yes? Sorry? I integrate the internal variable at the Gauss point, yes, for plasticity, P, for instance, this variable. I have to do that. In fact, I use the standard structure of most finite program. You have the global resolution and the local integration, so we don't eliminate. We really integrate there, and then we give the value of the increment of stress, and this is we have an increment of strain. We integrate with the implicit Newton method locally, and then we get the increment of stress, and we give back to for the equilibrium, and then we have an implicit we have two. There is a need for integration locally and also for globally, and the most difficult one is the global, in fact, also. But we have very small time step locally also. What can be said is that you introduce the gradient, it's better than when you have the classical, because the integration of the softening in classical plasticity, you can do it. Huh? For instance, this simulation here, this one, is mesh dependent. You can do it. Yes, this one. But the time step are close to zero. It's very stiff. No, because here it's plasticity, so it's strain driven. So I don't have so much. It's not so terrible as brittle damage. It's true. Plasticity is nice in some sense in that case. Huh? If not, indeed you have to work on that. Yeah. But probably when I have problems, probably it's related to that, and probably I should improve in that sense. Okay. Yeah. What do you need, by?
When you say you solve the
global problem is discrete. Yeah.
Back to the displacements and to the.
I solve it monolithic. Yes, in monolithic way. Yes, because it's a standard generalized material, so it's everything is nice, in fact. Yeah. But indeed, I have to I solve it once for both families of degrees of freedom. Possibility would be to solve with one and then iterate, but here I take the strong coupling. So I'm not sure it's the best way. Probably we will learn more this afternoon, because I think you do it staggered, perhaps. Or, you know, yeah. This can be more efficient. Okay. The last question here is. Okay, but you see the form is. We see the form, but we don't see the microstructure. It's a pity. We could learn more from the microstructure to identify the macroscopic model, because this is a phenomenological approach. What I have shown, I have model, identify the parameter from strain fields, but I don't look at the cells. We looked at the cells a bit, what we can learn. I must say that I will not give definite answer on that. This is the end. Because we know that the structure of the form exactly in 3D, because we have performed some microtomography experiment in Grenoble by the European synchrotron facility. So we know everything on each cell in a certain region. So in principle, we should predict everything. So we have tried. So remember that the struts here are hollow here. Okay, you see the thickness of the walls, so something like 10 micron. So it's really a wonderful material with one grain in the thickness, look at the grains here, grain boundaries. Okay. And this is an image of tomography here. So this is a cut, and this is a 3D image of one cell by a 3D microtomography. So you see the cell. So we can see if it's really what is the shape of the polyhedron. And we did a statistic here. It's interesting because one of the questions in geometry of a foam is what is the exact the mean polyhedron for such a material. And if you look in the literature, there are only a few people who really counted and analyzed each cells, and there is one guy during the Matske, I think it was in Czech Republic, I think, he measured during the Second World War all the cells of a foam, a soap foam, in fact. And he measured each and to take the polyhedron, and he measured that it was there was a certain number of edges. For instance, I think he found something like 13.2 or something like this, or I don't remember, not exactly 14, which is Kelvin periodic shape, and that we usually use to represent this. You know, the tetrakaidecaedron, which is a periodic structure, which is a bit like that. And the reality is here. So he did that for, I think he had something like 100 cells. I think he lost some eyes. Yeah? Here we analyzed 1,000 of them. It was almost the first time of this. We give a number which did not exist in the literature. Number of faces, number of ages, number of nodes for 1,000 cells. After that, people in Marseille did 5,000. Later on. Okay, we stopped because we could not anymore. Okay. And what do we learn? You learn that there are some faces which are hexagonal. You have faces which are pentagonal. And I think they should be also square sometimes, but I don't see it, not so many. So it's a mixture of tetradecahedron and the pentagonal dodecahedron. Which is a shape built only of five pentagonal faces, which are not periodic, so you cannot really make a tiling of them. You have to mix them with other quantities, in fact. So the exact shape, we have a statistic for that. For those who are interested, we have the statistical distribution. It's not exactly tetradecahedron, not exactly pentagonal. It's something in between. Okay. So, now this is the curve for pure nickel. We reproduced a foil of nickel with thickness 10 micrometer, very thin, with the same grain size by heat treatment and recrystallization. Because, if of course, you know that the behavior of metal depends on grain size, dislocation density. So, when you say in homogenization that you know the constituent, yeah, you have to take care. So, we reproduce the same material, and since the foam also has a heat treatment, we hope we have the same dislocation density. But at least we had the same grain size. So, we have a foil. And we do the tension test. So this is what we find. So the curve is a bit fuzzy because it's a thin film. So the loading cell was a bit too high, and we have some fluctuation. But you see a very nice hardening. So the nickel, pure nickel, is as a thin film, is a hardening material which breaks very abruptly. Also, this is also interesting. Also, this is metal. You should expect ductile fracture, but it's so thin that it's really brittle at the end. Hardening, and then it breaks, which is difficult to model. Also, I did not discuss on that. Okay, so we take this as the behavior of the foam, and we will plug it in a mesh, a full mesh, finite element mesh of the cells that we have from the 3D microtomography. Okay, so we know the geometry, we know the constitutive behavior, so we should predict the behavior of the foam, simply. So we tried. Okay, here we have only one cell and a bit of neighbors, a small volume element. Okay, so this is the plasticity which develops, I think. No, this is a Mises stress. So we see the Mises stress, so you see that because there are theories of foams saying that you are in bending or you are in tension, Here the reality is much more complicated because you see the junctions between beams is clumsy. It's a huge one, huh? It's a large part. So you have all stresses, in fact. But you can locate stress concentration in the junctions, and this is where probably it will break, in fact. Yeah. Okay, so we deform it. This is very hard. And these are simulations, they are already almost 10 years old. Huh? Nowadays everything is easy, but at that time it was very difficult. And the poor students are now famous because of the work, and they found good jobs in the industry also. See, even if you do this, you don't lose your eyes and brain. In fact, it's hard, yes, because when you mesh it, it does not work. You have by hand to change some problems locally because there is no meshing, automatic meshing 3D that works each time. This is proved by Paul Louis George, and he says that we cannot mesh in 3D. We cannot, but if you have good students, you can do it. Yeah. I mean, when mathematicians say we cannot, engineer they can, of course. Huh? You know that. Huh? So we have made it. I see that you don't like this joke, eh?
No.
Yeah. Okay, we can discuss this at...
check what you have done.
Yeah. We'll check now with the experiment. Look. Okay. So we modified a bit the reality by some solving local problem, but at the end we get still... So here you have a lot of deformation. This one, for instance, you have some tensile of the... an alignment of the foam here, of the strut. Okay, and then we compare with the experiment, with these cells, which is a small cell. So we see that this is the prediction in a transverse direction, the one is rolling direction, and the experiment. So at least we find the factor 2 is almost there in our simulation. It proves that it's entirely due to the anisotropy of the shape, because we have put the von Mises criterion for the grains. Eh? So the plasticity in nickel is isotropic. Huh? But we don't recover exactly the same. This is not bad, but this is a bit underestimated, in fact, here. And we don't describe very well the elasticity, which is strange. It's not so easy to have the proper elasticity properties by this technique. I don't know why. In fact, there are several people working on that. They are always difficult to do. Okay, but we are interested in plasticity. So you may say, oh, the reason why it does not work is because your representative volume element is not representative. It was too small. So we tried with larger one. Look, this one. So this is a masterpiece. It is a masterpiece. It has 5 million degrees of freedom. Contains about 25 cells, something like this, if you count the cut cells also. So it's not sure that it's representative yet. Huh? You imagine that we have mesh very thin because it's hollow inside. Huh? So you have we have walls, in fact, thickness of 10 microns. And then you have some bumps at the junctions. So it's a complicated mesh. This one needed a lot of work, I must say. And then, this is this one. Okay, and then we look at the plastic strain. Okay, we curve this curve. I think it is superimposed between the student said that there is only 8 cells because 8 closed cells inside. And the unit cell with the first one, you see there is not so much difference. Huh? So in fact, in plasticity, you don't need so many cells to have the right estimate of the plastic behavior. It's not so true for elasticity, and it's because we don't have very good result for elasticity. But it's true for foam, it's true also for polycrystals. You may say for polycrystal in elasticity you need perhaps for your volume element 1,000 grains, and in plasticity you need 10,000. It's not true. 1,000 for the elasticity is true, for anisotropy. But 100 grains already gives you in plasticity a good value of the effective properties. So we have a good estimation of the anisotropy with that, in fact. Okay, now we wanted to go a step further, and we wanted to say what is the micro deformation of Erringen. What is Ehringen's micro deformation? Can we identify here for the foam what a micro deformation is? We know what the deformation is. It is, for instance, if you take sort of cells, idealized cells of, that you periodize, for instance, you can say, okay, the sort of center of mass of the cell is the microscopic displacement, and then we have the line relating this center of mass are the material lines, let's say. But what is the micro deformation? So we did the following. We consider individual cells, and we separate them by image analysis, and we consider the volumes that they represent, and we consider the inertia tensor of these cells. They delimitate some non-material direction, so like in Ehringen, D directors, and we try to look at these volumes, how they were at the beginning and how they are at the end. For instance, here you have the volume, the starting one, I don't remember which one it is. We have superimposed the initial one and the deformed state. So we had tomography, so we had the initial state, then we deform, we have a 3D image, we do again the image analysis, and you will see the new shape of the cell. So we see that the shape is transformed. We have two views here, of the top and from side. And what I plot here is the orientation of the eigenvectors of the inertia tensor of each cell. I classify them by the order of the eigenvalues, because it's a sort of ellipsoid, so you have higher values and smaller values. So I think C is the largest one. And you see that there is during the transformation, the C was along a normal direction. Those who can read polar stereographic projection, okay. So you see that C was aligned with the normal direction, the elongated direction of the cell. And then, if you deform it, it changed. Probably, we pulled in the direction of rolling. And you elongate in this direction, and then the longest ellipse parameter is then along this direction. So you have a change, and no real change of orientation. You see the orientation is almost the same. So we did that for a few cells, so it's different here. You have again a change in the nature of the direction, largest or smallest, but you have also a small tilt. You see, you have a rotation. For instance, here, this axis of the cell, I don't know which one exactly it is here, probably this. It was a C, it's become a B, so intermediate. But you have also a rotation of the eigenvector, so the cells rotated. Okay. Now we have a group of cells, we can do the same and do it for several group of cells. And for instance, here we superimpose the extracted polyhedron, initial and deformed. You can look exactly how it deforms. Okay. And then what we have done, we have considered the motion of the edges of the cells. Okay, we take the edges of the cells, and we try to identify a uniform transformation which best fit the transformation of the edges. So we take, like Germain proposed, in fact, he proposed that the micromorphic degrees of freedom can be interpreted as an expansion with a macroscopic displacement plus chi, the matrix of micro deformation, multiplied by, but will be then the position minus the, I don't know, perhaps I should take y for the, and you have the center of mass here of the cell. Let's say X, yeah. And this is a sort of expansion that you can continue. And so this is a linear transformation, affine transformation. And we fit, well, the displacement is easy to find, but we fit also this on the motion of the nodes. I don't say this is the only way to treat the data, but we did that. And for that, we get a microstrain, micro deformation, the full of Ehringen. And then you compare this micro deformation with what? With the compare chi with which other quantity, macroscopic quantity. If you don't answer, we start again the whole school. So I need an answer. We compare chi with, yes, strain in some sense, so with F. In fact, directly, we compare chi with F. Because F we know, this is what we give to the macroscopic strain, so we know the F, we measure it, we impose this, we measure this, so we know exactly the F. And then we can compare the chi with that. So what do we get? So here, the F macroscopic is here. So in the material frame. So you see that we impose something like, it's here, 15% epsilon. And we had some contraction, which is not homogeneous, you see, not isotropic. It's not so different here. And this is what you find for chi, for the micro deformation of Erringen, for individual cells. Look, this one has not 15%, but has 13%. This one, I'd show you two of them. Here you have more, you have 17%. And of course you have some shear, which does not exist here, because we measured, it's not, there is no shear. It's microscopic deformation, it's anisotropic, but it's orthotropic, so you have no shear, in fact. Of course, you have 1%, not so much. Here, 0. Okay, and here, what we computed is a polar decomposition of chi. Chi is a microdeformation tensor. You can consider the polar decomposition, so you have the rotation of the cell, of the eigenvectors. And you see that they, okay, it's not so much, and this is the almost one here, and the sinus of the angular rotation, which are here. So, and I think this is the only measurement that that we have for that. So, it remains open, I would say, because once we have this data, how can I use them to really identify a micromorphic model? I mean, this would be a part of your work, perhaps, for different materials. And I thank you. I stop here. So if you have questions, you have a bit of time for questions. Yeah?
How do you define the cell?
It's by image analysis, in fact. So we have the density map with gray level, and then we take we fill the struts by dilatation of morphological analysis. So we fill the struts, then we take the skeletons, and which is a standard procedure in morphology, and then we have the skeleton, and we take the intersection of the main branches of the skeleton. You know, the skeleton can be a bit branchy, but in such a structure, you have the network connecting the nodes. In fact, so the intersection, we call them nodes. That's how it has been done. So it's purely geometrical.
So you have nodes and edges.
Yeah.
Now, how can you define the set?
Polyhedron, closed one. I think it was done by the eyes, I would say, to really. No, because we had a lot. Of course we can do that, because we did that. Look here. This is by filling, then, from the edge, we can fill inside, in fact, where you have to define the faces. Faces is possible to define because we have edges, so we have closed polyhedron, and so I don't know exactly how he did that, because this is really morphology that you have to apply. But to define the this picture here that you have here, this one, for instance, this object. I don't remember exactly how we did that, so I have to ask, but there is a procedure, which is, of course, a bit heuristic, because it's image analysis in 3D, but which deliver a closed cell. Probably it's due to the convexity of the, it's essential that we have convex cells, in fact. Because the algorithm that I use, they would not work if you have non-convex cells, especially grains, for instance, which are non-convex. So I think the algorithm works here because of that, because it's possible to find a way to isolate them because of convexity. I think this is a bit like sort of Voronoi, if you want. Because you have the center of mass also of this. I don't remember the exact procedure, but I think it's linked to the convexity strongly. And it would not work for some complex shape, in fact. Yeah. Okay, nobody wants to determine the further the micro deformation.
I have a question. You have introduced a penalty.
Yeah?
Somewhere.
Yeah, I can show you.
So your idea is that at the end you should have a higher gradient material. You have more or less an idea. Because if you call it penalty, it means that you want it big.
I mean, a Young's modulus is a penalty to stray. Yeah? So this is in that sense. If you want, but okay. That, no,
you
no.
Are keeping rather distinct. I mean,
this is here.
If the field.
This.
Yes.
This.
If epsilon and chi s are
close. This is what I was doing. This is what. This is the last transparency. Is about this.
Yes.
It's exactly this.
So yeah. They are the same.
No, you said we have
they
seen.
Different.
They are different. A bit, not so much. You have seen the last one.
The question is, if they are very close, then you will get high concentrations of stress in the boundary region.
Yes.
In the corners.
Yeah,
in the edges.
Just a comment on that. That you see, it's not. It's f is not equal to chi. If you define chi by, because of course it's a matter of definition. These are higher degrees of freedom. So you have to define them. You cannot. Here I propose a definition which is heuristic in some sense, and you check that this is not equal to that. So you say chi of individual cells is not equal to the deformation gradient. But this is a random material, so is this this distinction from cell to cell only due to the randomness, or is it an intrinsic property saying that there is something like a micro deformation? I don't know.
Sorry,
I don't know.
Randomness is hidden where
the randomness is in the. Look at this picture. These are not tetrachaedecaedron. Huh?
This. Okay, so you use this simulation
these are the
to identify?
Yes, these are the true cells.
Okay, so you use this for micro-macro identification?
I tried, but I did not come to an identification, because I stopped here. At the kinematics already, I tried to identify the micro-deformation, and I say, okay, at least I would need perhaps 1,000 such measurements, which is a bit tough. Could be automatized, but okay, bon. And I don't know. Here we are in between homogenization for random materials, which can be standards, don't need higher order gradient necessarily, or the definition of Germain or Ehringen, saying that there is sort of micro deformation for each particle. Okay, I am at this stage. So you see, there is. And regarding the penalty, it's very important, of course. This is the most specific feature of micromorphic continuum. You see that, how I use it. In fact, this penalty, this modulus, this higher order modulus, I fix it. And I identify this one. Because it's too much for me to identify both, because I am not so clear on what is the difference between micro and macro deformation. So you see that I use the micromorphic continuum as a sort of computational tool, in fact, and perhaps it would be easier to use the strain gradient model completely. Yeah. Because you see, if you take the limit b going to infinity, or as Lagrange multiplier, then epsilon is equal to the micro strain, and the gradient of microstrain is the connected directly to the second gradient of displacement. So this would be a, but the micromorphic approach has computational advantages because here I don't need C1 shape function, for instance, not necessary.
Yes.
I use standard finite element with problems, of course, but standard ones. So you can view it as a computational tool, but I think it is more than that. It is really something physical, and I can give an argument on that simply to finish. It's already too late, but sorry for that. If I come back to that, and this one, take this one. If you dig this one, yes, this, which is most simple situation. So when you go older, you make things more simple. So you see, I get rid of the chi ij and all this stuff, and I remain only with one scalar quantity here, which was enough for most effect. So this, once I apply this concept to diffusion, P is replaced by C, the concentration, and C chi is something that I call micro concentration. And I did the same theory, purely for diffusion. And what do you get? You get, of course, equations which are similar to Cagnilliard equation, in fact, with this framework, if you put the constraint. And I made the presentation of this at a conference where Coleman was there. You know Coleman, he was 80, something like this, but he was there. And during my talk, he stood up and interrupted me. And then I was very scared because I knew that it was thermodynamics that I was transforming in a sort of strange thing. But he said, this term is a variance from the statistical... imagine that C, that P is a mean strain in the volume. Then you can define, imagine that P is heterogeneous inside, the plastic strain, the volume is heterogeneous. You can define the variance by, and you can consider P mean value minus P chi to the square, such that it is the definition of the variance of, over the whole volume, in fact. And then this gives a meaning to P chi, in fact. P chi is something like a signature of heterogeneity inside the volume element, in some sense, I would say. But I have no mathematical argument. I have only the idea of Coleman, that's right, that way.